This episode is brought to you by VPP Simplified. Now you can get element by element tracking and guidance for your VPP journey. Every aspect of the VPP requirements in one easy to use interactive spreadsheet. It explains every sub element in detail, contains an easy to read stoplight so you can track current status for each sub element. It provides you with a three-step verification for completion of each sub-element. There's even a notes section for you to compile language that will eventually be used for your VPP application. It even comes complete with graphs to show current state and track your progress moving forward. Look, achieving VPP star status can be tough, but understanding what it takes to get there can be simplified. This VPP gap tool will help you do that. Go to vppsimplified.com for more information.
Welcome to the Safety Pro Podcast, where we help you manage workplace safety one episode at a time. And now, your very own safety pro, Blaine J. Hoffman.
Welcome to another episode of the Safety Pro Podcast. We are going to talk about bloodborne pathogens. We are going to talk about what they are. We're going to talk about how to manage a bloodborne pathogens program. We're going to talk about whether or not you have first responders in your facility or on your sites. We're going to talk about all that good stuff. And we're going to jump right in with defining bloodborne pathogens and going over some definitions as well. So, you know, basically bloodborne pathogens are infectious microorganisms that are in human blood. They can cause diseases, things like hepatitis B, C, HIV, and others as well. They're not limited to these. These are just the big ones. And OSHA requires employers to protect employees who are occupationally exposed to blood or what they call other potentially infectious materials, such as unfixed human tissues and certain other bodily fluids, which we'll get into. So how do you know if you fall under occupationally exposed category? We're going to get into that. Basically, most employers associate exposure to bloodborne pathogens with healthcare workers, but there are many other occupations, including first aid team members, housekeeping personnel in some industries, and of course, various workers who, I'm using air quotes, may be at risk of occupational exposure to these pathogens. Something else to note, the OSHA bloodborne pathogen standard applies to all occupational exposures in the general industry. You're going to find this standard at 29 CFR 1910.1030, and that is, of course, the bloodborne pathogens standard. Before we jump into this topic, let's take a break and talk about the official floor marking, floor sign company of the Safety Pro Podcast. That is none other than Mighty Line Floor Tape. I've talked a lot about how, you know, Mighty Line knows the importance of safety to your organization. And of course, all of their products cover everything you need to implement a 5S system for increased productivity at your facility and, of course, increased safety for your workers. Here's something you may not have heard about yet, and I wanted to take a moment and talk about it. Mighty Line offers an absorbent mat. It's a great way to keep floors clean, dry, safe from the elements. These mats can save both time and money in your workplace because they're easily placed, easily disposable. Simply roll out and stick, and when you're finished, peel up the mat with little to no residue. And the mat, with its absorbent ability alongside Mighty Line tape, can create a safer, more organized work environment. Learn more by going to mightylinetape.com/podcast. While you're there, ask for a free sample of Mighty Line floor tape, the best in the industry. You can even catch past episodes of the Safety Pro Podcast. Again, mightylinetape.com/podcast. Getting back into today's topic, bloodborne pathogens, let's cover some definitions that are going to be important for you to understand as you start looking at whether or not this applies to you or you review your existing program. Now, blood means human blood. That includes human blood components and products made from human blood. The term includes plasma, platelets, other fluids from, you know, that exude from wounds. Also included in this definition of blood are medications derived from blood. Now, bloodborne pathogens means pathogenic microorganisms that are present in human blood and can cause diseases in humans. HBV and HIV are specifically identified in the standard. The term includes any pathogenic microorganism that is present in human blood or other potentially infectious materials and can infect and cause disease in persons who are exposed to blood containing those pathogens. These microorganisms, they can cause diseases like, as something I mentioned earlier, hepatitis C, B, but, you know, malaria, syphilis, relapsing fever, adult T-cell leukemia, lymphoma. So lots of pathogens can be found in human blood. It isn't just hepatitis C, hepatitis B, and HIV, although those are ones that you need to be concerned about. There's a lot of other ones out there. OSHA defines an exposure incident as a specific eye, mouth, other mucous membrane, non-intact skin, that includes skin with dermatitis, hangnails, cuts, chafing, even acne, or contact with blood or other potentially infectious materials that results from the performance of an employee's duties. So that's key. We'll talk about that. So what is an occupational exposure? Basically, it means reasonably anticipated skin, eye, mucous membrane, or other contact with blood or other potentially infectious materials that may result from the performance of an employee's duties. It does not include the Good Samaritan Act, okay? It doesn't include out in the public, you know, assisting somebody in need, just being a Good Samaritan. It is something that they have to be assigned a duty and they're expected to perform this task. Now, I've mentioned other potentially infectious materials, or OPIMs, are what OSHA refers to them as. I've mentioned that twice or three times now. What does that mean? One, the following human body fluids: semen, vaginal secretions, cerebrospinal fluid, synovial fluid, pleural fluid, there's peritoneal fluid, amniotic fluid, saliva in dental procedures, and any body fluid that is visibly contaminated with blood, and all body fluids in situations where it is difficult or impossible to differentiate between body fluids, those would be OPIMs. Also, any unfixed tissue or organ other than intact skin from a human, either living or dead. And three, the third category, HIV-containing cell or tissue cultures, organ cultures, and HIV or HBV-containing culture medium or other solutions, including blood, organs, other tissues from experimental animals that are infected with HIV or HBV. Okay, so we know it's blood, but then it's also other fluids that could be secreted from the body that may contain, or it's difficult to determine if they contain blood, things like that. Now, OSHA also regulates waste, right? They have a term called regulated waste. This means liquid or semi-liquid blood or other potentially infectious materials, contaminated items that would release blood or potentially infectious materials in a liquid or semi-liquid state if compressed. So if you have tissues or gauze, paper towels, that if you squeeze them, they would secrete this material, blood or other potentially infectious materials, that's regulated waste. OSHA uses another term called universal precautions. This is an approach to infection control to which they refer. According to the concept of universal precautions, all blood and certain human body fluids are treated as if known to be infectious. Universal precautions are assuming that it's contaminated so that you take the necessary precautions. And OSHA also refers to some work practice controls in their standard as well. These mean controls that reduce the likelihood of exposure by altering the manner in which a task is performed. For example, in healthcare, prohibiting recapping of needles by two-handed technique is an example of, you know, preventing needle stick injuries. In general, the OSHA standard requires employers that are covered to establish an exposure control plan. Now, this is a written plan to eliminate or minimize occupational exposures to bloodborne pathogens. The employer must prepare an exposure determination that contains a list of job classifications in which all workers have occupational exposure and a list of job classifications in which some workers have occupational exposure, along with a list of the tasks and procedures performed by those workers that result in their exposure. So, if you have an occupational health clinic on at your facility, if you have dedicated first responders, things like that, you would identify them, have the tasks there to perform listed in this plan. You have to update the plan annually to reflect changes in the tasks, procedures, and positions that affect occupational exposure. Also, any technological changes that eliminate or reduce occupational exposure should be noted as well. In addition, employers must annually document in the plan that they have considered and begun using appropriate, commercially available, effective, safer medical devices designed to eliminate or minimize occupational exposure. Employers must also document that they have solicited input from frontline workers in identifying, evaluating, and selecting effective engineering and work practice controls. So getting feedback from the workers that have to do these tasks is going to be critical. A lot of times they're going to have ideas about products, devices, personal protective equipment, supplies that they think they should use out on the in the field or out on the shop floor that would help minimize exposure and make their job as a first responder a lot easier. You're also required to implement the use of universal precautions sort of approach, right? And that is treating all human blood and OPIMs as if it's known to be infectious for bloodborne pathogens. You do that by simply stating that in your written policy, that all blood is to be considered infectious material and requires the use of precautions. You also have to identify and use engineering controls. These are devices that would isolate or remove the bloodborne pathogen hazards from the workplace. They include sharps disposal containers, self-sheathing needles, safer medical devices like sharps with engineered sharps injury protection and needleless systems if you have an occupational clinic. Things like that, you're kind of expected to always stay current on what is the standard practice or best practices available out there in the industry. You are also required to identify and ensure the use of work practice controls. Now, these are practices that they reduce the possibility of exposure simply by changing the way a task is done, such as appropriate practices for handling and disposing of contaminated sharps, or handling any kind of specimens, blood samples, handling laundry, and cleaning contaminated surfaces and items. By coming up with the correct way to deal with these things and writing these procedures and making sure employees understand what they're supposed to use and how they're supposed to clean work surfaces and dispose of materials, then you're identifying and ensuring the use of work practice controls. You have to make sure you cover this stuff. A lot of times you do first aid training, you talk about bloodborne pathogens and you have first responders, and then you kind of miss the whole, what do I do with the work area when we're done? What if this machine has some blood drops on it? What about the floor? What do I wipe that up with and where does that go? You also have to provide PPE. Just like any other workplace hazard, PPE like gloves, gowns, eye protection, and masks, the employer has to provide this information and these devices to the employees. You also have to make available hepatitis B vaccinations to all workers with occupational exposure. The vaccination, it has to be offered after the worker has received the required training and within 10 days of initial assignment to a job that could occupationally expose them to bloodborne pathogens. To that end, you also have to make available post-exposure evaluation and follow-up to any occupationally exposed worker who experiences the exposure incident. So if somebody has an exposure incident, remember that is a specific eye, mouth, or mucous membrane, non-intact skin, or something like that, any kind of exposure, then you have to offer a post-exposure evaluation. That includes, if they consent, offering post-exposure prophylaxis, counseling, evaluating any kind of reported illness, and the healthcare professional will provide a limited written opinion to the employer, and all diagnoses must remain confidential, of course, but you're going to want to offer that if somebody has an exposure or even thinks they got exposed you have to offer this post-exposure evaluation and follow-up. You also are required to use labels and signs to communicate hazards. Warning labels, for example, must be affixed to containers of regulated waste, containers of contaminated reusable sharps, refrigerators and freezers that contain blood or OPIMs, other containers used to store, transport, or ship blood or OPIM, or even bags or containers of contaminated laundry have to be marked, unless there's an exception provided by the standard. For example, facilities may use red bags or red containers instead of labels. A couple of other final points. Employers have to ensure that their workers receive regular training that covers all the elements of the standard, including but not limited to information on bloodborne pathogen and diseases, methods used to control occupational exposure, hepatitis B vaccine information, and medical evaluation, as well as post-exposure follow-up procedures that they can expect if they did unfortunately have or think that they had an exposure. So employers have to offer this training on initial assignment at least annually thereafter, and when new or modified tasks or procedures affect a worker's occupational exposure. And as always, like any other training, it has to be presented at an educational level and in a language that the workers can understand. Finally, you have to maintain worker medical and training records. You also must maintain a sharps injury log, unless it's exempt under Part 1904, the record keeping and recording and reporting of occupational injuries and illnesses for privacy issues, things like that. But yeah, you have to keep worker medical and training records on site. So let's get into a couple of questions that pop up sometimes. What about like box cutters or a utility knife blade? Are those required to go into a label or color-coded sharps container? Now, OSHA doesn't require that containers of uncontaminated sharps be labeled or color-coded in accordance with the bloodborne pathogen standard. However, a contaminated, I'm using air quotes again here, a contaminated sharp is any contaminated object that can penetrate the skin. It isn't limited to a needle. It could be glass. It could be metal, shards, things like that. Contaminated, again, means the presence or reasonably anticipated presence of blood or other potentially infectious materials on the surface. It's not just something that's visibly contaminated. It's something you could suspect is contaminated. Contaminated sharps are considered regulated waste and have to be disposed of according to the standard. They have to be discarded in containers that are closable, puncture-resistant, leak-proof on the sides and bottom, and labeled or color-coded according to the standard. Now, if you use a label, it has to include that biological hazard symbol as well as the word biohazard. However, red containers may be substituted for the label if you just have a red container. So remember, uncontaminated sharps aren't regulated under the bloodborne pathogen standard. Only contaminated sharps, and a sharp is any contaminated object that can penetrate the skin. I mentioned this earlier, but it's a common question. Are small bandages required to go in a red bag or labeled biohazard waste container? Again, only regulated waste needs to be disposed of in a labeled or color-coded container. So bandages would not be considered regulated waste if they are not saturated to the point of releasing blood or other potentially infectious materials if compressed, as I alluded to earlier, okay? Nor caked with dried blood or other potentially infectious materials to the point that the dried blood or OPIM is capable of releasing these materials during handling. So if those two conditions exist, dried material can be released during handling, or if compressed, it could release the liquid. That is regulated waste. If not, it's not regulated, and OSHA does not require a label or color-coded disposal container. And OSHA allows employers to toss non-regulated waste in a regular trash bin. But as a best practice, if you take a bandage off of somebody's wound, throw it in the biohazard bag or container. Bottom line, if you have first responders, you need to provide them the training that they need to have in order to do their job safely. The first rule of any first responder is their personal safety comes first. If they can't protect themselves, they can't really help somebody else in need. That goes for sizing up the scene and making sure that there are no hazards around that could injure them during the course of helping somebody else, whether it's electrical hazards, confined space, hazards like hazardous atmosphere, moving parts and machinery, things like that, and making sure that they have the right personal protective equipment to help somebody who is bleeding and injured. That's key. You have to make sure you equip them with the materials they need to do this job safely. So, where do you have first responder bags around your facility or on your project sites? Do you keep them in an accessible area, but maybe you zip tie them and do a monthly inspection to make sure the materials in there haven't expired, haven't been degraded over time, are fresh and ready to use? Do you have an inspection log and a rhythm around that? Do employees have regular first responder meetings where they talk about first response, ways to respond to different incidents? Because statistically, they're not going to use that training a whole lot, right? That's, if all of our other prevention efforts work the way that they're intended to work in the workplace, then you're probably not going to have a whole lot of incidents. So, you know, if you use it, you lose it type of approach here. The training is great, but you have to make sure you have regular meetings and you keep this fresh and you have them bring the bags to the meeting and they empty the first responder bag and then repack it so that they're familiar with where things go and where things are located. Make sure the gloves, little tips like this, make sure the gloves are right at the top of the first responder bag so that as soon as you open the bag, the first thing you grab are the gloves. You don't have to dig for those. So, you know, have meetings. Talk regularly with your first responders. Get feedback from what they're seeing out there on the shop floor, in the workplace, on the job sites. Make sure you include them in any changes to your program and training. I wanted to throw a quick topic out there. Bloodborne pathogens, one that I wanted to get to, and I'm glad I was able to talk a little bit about it. I hope I was able to get you started looking at a bloodborne pathogen program or reviewing the one you already have. And I hope I was able to give you some information that OSHA requires of you if you have people that would be occupationally exposed to bloodborne pathogens. I hope I started you off in the right direction. If you have any questions, hit the email link in the show notes. I'm always taking emails from people that listen to the podcast. I love hearing from everybody out there. So please keep the emails coming. I try to answer everybody, you know, within, you know, several days, but it's getting tough. There's a lot of emails come through. So, but I like them. I'll get to them. And, you know, I've had some good suggestions via email that are going to actually make it as topics on the podcast like I've done in the past. So please keep your suggestions coming as well. Please visit thesafetypropodcast.com for information about must-read books that will help you, if you're a safety professional, be a better leader, a team builder. There's a lot of tools on the resources page of the website. If you go to thesafetypropodcast.com and click on resources, you'll see that information there. You can catch past episodes from the webpage as well. And again, don't forget to visit our incredible sponsor. I love these guys, Mighty Line Floor Tape. So mightylinetape.com/podcast is where you're going to find information about their products and services. Great folks, great products. If you have to mark your floors or you need floor signs and labels of any kind, you've got to check out their information. Go to mightylinetape.com/podcast. And until the next Safety Pro Podcast episode, please be safe.